You know, we've all been, acclaiming the eloquence of Martin Luther King and that great March on Washington that we celebrated 50th anniversary. And when I think of the accomplishments of minorities, I'm looking at the person we've got today. This girl had a mother who recognized her genius, but the kid has an IQ that's equal to, like, Mozart and Newton. 199. It's off the chart. And we're going to talk about it. Isn't that amazing?
Yes. We want to know what her mother ate when she was in vitro.
Broccoli, darling. It must have been broccoli.
I guess that's it.
But seriously, I mean, but the fact that she recognized
her. That's amazing.
Homeschooler. I mean, this is an amazing, amazing person. And we're going to talk about that today. And we've got some other exciting things. But in the news, of course, that crazy Muslim who massacred people at Fort Hood. He has now been sentenced to death by lethal injection. But some people question if the government could have stopped the attack before it happened.
Now Major Nidal Hassan's case faces years, maybe even decades, of appeals. Charlene Israel has the story.
It's a sentence 4 years in the making.
This has been a very long and exhausting process. We are tired. We are hurt. But we are resolved. Justice has been served.
The same jury that convicted Major Nidal Hassan on 13 counts of premeditated murder chose the death penalty Wednesday over life in prison without parole. Many worried that a death sentence was exactly what Hassan wanted in his quest for martyrdom. Only weeks ago, his standby defense team asked to be relieved because they felt Hassan was seeking a guilty verdict. But victims say it's a sentence they'll accept.
It was a concern of some, but I am just fine with that now because it will take a very long time for him to be executed, and it is a much stiffer punishment than life without parole.
They say it's a sentence that fits the heinousness of the crime. Among those killed, a pregnant mother who pleaded for her unborn child before Hassan killed her. Now that this phase of the victim's quest for justice is over, many are turning their attention to another issue, a civil case against the government. They say the attack should be reclassified as combat-related instead of workplace violence to make victims eligible for more medical benefits and to recognize those who fought back with military decorations. During his trial, Hassan stated that he attacked the unarmed soldiers in order to protect Muslim insurgents in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Anyone who would use their religion to commit acts of terrorism serves no God except their own hatred and self-interest.
The suit also slams the FBI. The left-wing magazine Mother Jones recently reported on FBI emails that show Hassan was on the Bureau's radar nearly a year before the Fort Hood massacre. They intercepted several emails between Hassan and Anwar al-Awlaki, a radical Islamic cleric with ties to 9/11.
He was radicalized, and I think a lot of those red flags were ignored. So, you know, in this era of extremist Islamist behavior, we have to take note of people that are making contact with those that are practicing that type of behavior.
The FBI decided against interviewing Hassan or his superiors because they didn't want their investigation into al-Awlaki to harm Hassan's career. One agent described the case as politically sensitive. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Thanks, Charlene. Ladies and gentlemen, when are we going to wake up and recognize that political correctness is going to kill this nation? I mean, we must fight against enemies, people who want to destroy us. And we cannot continually keep silence because of this pernicious doctrine that we call political correctness. Well, there's something else that's perhaps pernicious. There was gas, chemical gas, loosed on innocent civilians in Syria. The question now is, who did it? There's some thinking the government under current regime was not responsible. And it may have been some terrorists trying to put the blame on the Assad regime. Well, the United States may not be rushing to launch a military strike, even though we've been promised such a thing. And Lee Webb has more on that story from the CBN newsroom. Here's Lee.
Pat, the president still has not decided how to respond to the chemical weapons attacks on civilians in Syria. He says there's no doubt the Syrian government, in his mind, used the weapons on its own people. He says any American response would send a strong signal to Syrian President Bashar al-Assad. The Pentagon has positioned a fifth U.S. destroyer armed with cruise missiles off Syria's coast. U.S. intelligence believes Assad's forces were most likely responsible for that chemical weapons attack, but the Associated Press reports that remains uncertain. Meanwhile, more than 100 members of Congress say they want to vote before any military strike. But the government of Great Britain says the legal conditions have been clearly met for taking action against Syria. Israel is preparing for a worst-case scenario if the U.S. does launch an attack on Syria. A strike could bring retaliation on the Jewish state. Chris Mitchell has that story from Jerusalem.
The Israeli army stepped up its alert level this week, deploying air defenses around the country and calling up a limited number of reservists. Israeli civilians are also flocking to get their gas masks.
This is one of the many gas mask distribution centers throughout Israel. We've just been told it's about a 3 or 4 hour wait to get your gas mask here. Many Israelis feel that if Bashar Assad doesn't mind using chemical weapons against his own people, then he won't mind killing Israelis.
But despite tension and the rush on gas masks, most Israelis are staying calm.
It's scary, yeah. Kind of worrying. We're very close by, and I hope things sort out peacefully.
I've lived here 43 years. I would imagine that I would be stupid not to be concerned. Afraid? Well, no.
You know, we are a very small country. Israel is very small, but God takes care of Israel.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu urged Israelis to maintain their daily routines, but warned that Israel is ready for action. We are prepared for any scenario. The IDF is ready to defend against any threat and to respond strongly against any attempt to harm Israeli citizens. Despite the warning, most analysts believe chances are low that Israel will get dragged into a war with Syria.
It all depends on the nature of the strike. If it's basically a punitive measure, nothing will happen. If it goes after decapitating the regime, anything could happen.
Middle East expert Michael Wiglansky says Assad is afraid of Israel's retaliation.
The Syrians know that the Israelis mean business, and they'll try to stay away from Israel unless they're being suicidal or unless they realize that they're going down.
Still, he says, this is the Middle East, and anything could happen. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Gospel singer Donnie McClurkin was scheduled to appear at a concert honoring Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., but the mayor of Washington disinvited him because he felt McClurkin's appearance would cause controversy. Gay rights activists opposed his appearance as well. McClurkin says God delivered him, though, from homosexuality, and Ephraim Graham talked with McClurkin at his annual Celebration of Unity.
Thousands answered Donnie McClurkin's annual call to New York City. It's the 10th year for the worship experience, designed to unite people of all denominations.
Jesus made the statement, he said, the house that's divided against its own self won't be able to stand. We've gained the commerciality of religion, but we've lost the power and the zeal. And we don't fellowship. It's quite often that you'll find the pastors really don't fellowship unless they're trying to do something political.
This year's conference comes on the heels of some unexpected political controversy for the New York pastor. Just weeks ago, the Washington, D.C. mayor's office withdrew its invitation for the gospel artist to perform at a concert honoring the 50th anniversary of the Martin Luther King Jr. I Have a Dream speech.
I was very good and very personal friends with Coretta Scott King for years.
Still, the mayor's office withdrew its invitation because of protests from members of the gay community in objection to McClurkin's longtime testimony of being delivered from homosexuality. McClurkin's answer to the protests, love.
And I don't speak evil about the sin at all. I speak the truth that sin is not of God and it's not right. And God didn't call us to sin. But as far as the people, no matter who you are, no matter who you love, I'm not gonna bash you. I'm going to love on you, and I'm going to continue to show you the love, even if you never change. Because love is not love if it's conditional.
He even had a chance to demonstrate that love. In the middle of all the D.C. uproar, a gay man approached him for prayer at a New York hotel.
I said, you don't know what I think about this at all. You know what I think, James? I think God is in love with James. I think God loves James, and I think I love James too. And he just cried in my arms, prayed again, let him go. And I went upstairs in my room and said, God, you are so ironic.
And this weekend, the pastor shared that same message of God's love to thousands.
The call of ministry is so strong, and it's such an honor. I don't want to commercialize it. I don't want it to be something that's slicked down and made palatable to the people. I want it to be in its raw essence, its raw form. I want it to reach the masses with the love of Jesus Christ. Pure, unconditional, raw.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
And Ephraim tells us that McClurkin also received significant support on social media after the D.C. controversy. Some of that support is from the gay and lesbian community, we're told. 8 years after Hurricane Katrina slammed into the Gulf Coast, New Orleans is on the rebound. Parts of the Crescent City still show signs of incredible damage. Thousands of people were trapped in their homes when the levees broke and floodwaters rose. Federal, state, and local authorities were all sharply criticized for their early responses. Katrina's damage estimates go as high as $150 billion when you include all the rebuilding that's been necessary. But Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal now calls New Orleans America's comeback city, Pat.
Well, it certainly is. You know, Lee, we had a significant presence down there. A lot of people came in, I'm sorry to say, and, well, they had news crews with them. They had photographers, excuse me, and they took pictures, and they stood in front of desolated buildings. Then they went back, got on their planes, and went back home. We stayed month after month after month after month, rebuilding houses, feeding the people, ministering in hospitals, helping people in every way possible. And I think that has had a lasting impact. When I say we, we're talking about Operation Blessing primarily. But we cared about New Orleans, and we were thrilled to be part of that effort after Katrina. But the response of FEMA and some of the federal people in there was just absolutely appalling. It was appalling. And it was graft-ridden. It was confused. It was bureaucratic overlay. It was just horrible what happened. But the people are coming back, and I'm delighted that the Governor Jindal has said it's a comeback city, and we applaud New Orleans. They're so nice to you when you go down there. I have more fun. It's such a fun place.
It's a beautiful city. It's a city of great history. And, of course, the Saints were a big part of celebrating that comeback,
yeah.
Too.
Well, Drew Brees, yeah. I mean, they've paid him big bucks to do that.
He's performed.
He's performed. All right.
Secretary of State John Kerry is asking Iran to release three U.S. citizens. One of them is Christian pastor Saeed Abedini. Pastor Abedini is a dual U.S.-Iranian citizen, and in a statement Wednesday, Kerry pointed out the pastor has spent almost 1 year in prison in Iran, sentenced on charges related to his religious beliefs. Kerry is appealing to Iran's new leader, saying President Rouhani has expressed interest in improving Iran's relations with the U.S. New York and Massachusetts could be the next states to ban what's known as conversion therapy. Therapists use the method as treatment, trying to help kids with unwanted same-sex attraction. Lawmakers in both New York and Massachusetts are considering measures to outlaw the practice. Just last week, New Jersey Governor Chris Christie signed a measure banning it in the state. Currently, California is the only other state to do so. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.